Okay, please, I will need it.
This is going to be sweat. Sister, stand up there.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
From the Supreme Court, along the Chief Judge of Edo State, other justices here present, principal officers of the university, provost, deans and directors, invited guests, staff and students, ladies and gentlemen. It is my pleasure to welcome each and every one of us to the 16th Justice Idigbe Memorial Lecture, organized by the Faculty of Law, University of Benin. Today is a special day in the university, and we are glad to have you with us. Permit me to quickly introduce our dear Vice Chancellor, who is here all by himself as the chief host of this program. Please join me in welcoming Engineer Professor Osase Faraday Orunwese, Fellow Nigerian Society of Engineers, Fellow Nigerian Environmental Society, Fellow Nigerian Society of Material Sciences, and member of the Nigerian Institute of Management. We want to welcome you, our dear Vice Chancellor. I want to quickly recognize the Chief Judge of Edo State. The Dean Faculty of Engineering will be in better position to recognize our special guest, and so we are going to leave the big fish for the last for a better introduction. We recognize the Chief Judge of Edo State, Honorable Justice E.F. Igbome. The Deputy Vice Chancellor at Kewan Campus, Professor George Henry Abreu. The Registrar of the University, O.A. Oshodi, Mrs. The seated Deputy Vice Chancellor Academic, we want to welcome you, sir, Professor Pius. The Registrar, the librarian of our university, Dr. Mrs. Ime Omoloabi Idioti. We want to welcome you. Permit me to quickly recognize Honorable Justice Dr. Onibokun of Osun State Judiciary. May I welcome to the high table Honorable Justice Stella Ogene, Honorable President, Delta State Customary Court of Appeal. They said if you don't come, I should stop talking. Thank you very much. You're welcome. Thank you.
Okay.
From the Court of Appeal, we want to welcome to the High Table Justice S.C. Osedu. Our officers may not be able to recognize you, please, sir. But just thank you very much. Also, to join them is Justice Moore Ademere.
You can see it here.
Justice Mudashiro Oniyanke. You know, when they tell you this is how we want it, you better behave. Thank you very much, sir. We also want to recognize the presence of Honorable Justice A.M. Yamusoy, Edo State Judiciary. Honorable Justice D.I. Okumbawa, Edo State Judiciary. Honorable Justice A.N. Asemocha, Edo State Judiciary. Honorable Justice P.O. Isibo, former President, Customary Court of Appeal, Edo State. May I welcome to the High Table representatives of the Idigbe family. Onyeka, Eiwo, please to the High Table, and Angela is the one, the representative of the Idigbe family. We want to welcome Honorable Justice Masha Omokoro. CJ Delta State. Here, ably represented by Honorable Justice Unduka Obi. Please, this way, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, sir. We also want to recognize the presence of Honorable Justice C.N. Ojubana. I recognize the presence of the Dean School of Basic Medical Sciences, Professor Mrs. Obo. I also want to recognize the Dean that has left, the Dean Faculty of Life Sciences, Professor Mrs.
Senabu.
Mr. Vice Chancellor has a plan for the university. That one day, University of Benin will feed University of Benin and feed Ekosofi, feed PDP, feed Osasofi, extend it to Ubo, and then Edo State at large through the Dean Faculty of Agriculture, Professor Bamikole.
No, what I saw today, you said what you asked me to do.
Whenever we see him, we know that he is Unibe, and Unibe is him. Because he remains an ambassador of the University of Benin. We are so proud to say that he was the first senior advocate of Nigeria produced in the University of Benin. Chief Charles Edoso, let's read it. He visited the Vice Chancellor's team. The Dean Faculty of Engineering, we want to welcome you, sir. It is Professor Kes Obayabo. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir. The Dean of the faculty I came from is also here. The Dean Faculty of Education, Professor Miyawa. We want to welcome you, sir. I also want to recognize the member of the Governing Council, former Dean Faculty of Law, University of Benin, Professor Richard Igbo, PhD. Your students are clapping very hard. Have they seen their results? the UAB chairman, Professor Omori. The chairman, Shoto Arenkas, is also seated, Professor Agbofo. Professor American Doba, who wants to work on this. May I quickly recognize the Deputy Registrar, School of Postgraduate Studies, Richard Omagumi Esquire. Well, he'll be here with us as we proceed. We will continually recognize each and everyone of us that have come to be a part of this program. May I recognize the Dean Faculty of Law, Professor Inegu. And so may I now invite the Dean to now come and officially welcome our special guest, the Dean.
My Lord, Honorable Justice Chima Sentus Mwizi, PhD, JSC, my Lord, Justices of the Court of Appeal, JST, my Lord, the Honorable Chief Judge of the Edo State, JST, Mr. Vice Chancellor, Principal Officers, JST, my Lords, Honorable Judges of the Edo State Judiciary, my fellow deans, JST, professors, learned colleagues, great Nigerian students, ladies and gentlemen, citation of Honorable Justice Chima Sentus Mwezi, PhD, JSC. Honorable Justice Chima Sentus Mwezi, a native of Obolu-Udenu local government area of Enugu State, was born on September 25th, 1958. A practicing Christian of the Roman Catholic denomination, is married to Honorable Justice Ugonne Jacinta Mwezi of the Enugu State Judiciary. Their union is blessed with 5 children and a grandchild. Honorable Justice Mwezi attended St. John Cross Seminary in Osuka from 1972 to 1977, graduating with a distinction in the West African School Certificate Examination between 1979 and 1983. He was an undergraduate student at the University of Nigeria in Enugu campus. In 1983, he represented the Faculty of Law and he did all Nigerian law faculties at the Philip Jesuit International Law Moot Court Competition in Washington, D.C., as the chief oralist. Upon his graduation in 1983, he proceeded to the Nigerian Law School from 1983 to 1984, where he obtained the qualifying certificate. He did his NYC between 1984 and 1985 in Bauchi City. Subsequently, he returned to the University of Nigeria Enugu campus between 1993 and 1995, where he studied for and obtained his LLM between 1997 and 2001. He studied for and achieved the doctorate degree of the same university, University of Nigeria. Judicial career. Having practiced at the private bar from 1985 to 1995, he was elevated to the High Court bench of Enugu State in November 1995. While at the High Court bench, he served as chairman, second robbery and firearms tribunal in Enugu State 1996 to 1998, chairman, robbery and firearms tribunal of Sukwa 1998 to 1999, member of Edo State Local Government Election Petition Tribunal 1999, chairman, Ogun State Governorship and Legislative House Election Petition Tribunal 1999, Administrative Judge, Ogunsuka Judicial Division, Enugu State 2001. He was appointed a Justice of the Court of Appeal of Nigeria February 15, 2008, and served there until October 2014, where he was finally elevated to the Nigeria State Court as a Justice of the Supreme Court of Nigeria October 29, 2014. He has been on the bench of the Supreme Court from October 2014 till date. Honorable Justice Chima Sentos Nwezi has served in various capacities in extrajudicial professional activities. These include member, DFID Access to Justice Program, Enugu State, 2003, member, National Working Group on the Reform of Criminal Justice and Judicial, 2004, the Admission of Criminal Justice Act is the brainchild of this group. Team member, Enugu State Sector Strategic Plan 2014, part DFID Honorary Consultant, District Health System Laws / Regulations 2004, member, Osinwon C-Expert Consultative Forum on Federal Budget Act and Facilitator, Enugu State Justice Sector Reform Team. A former convener and coordinator, LLF International Human Rights Program, and VC Human Rights Scholar, Faculty of Law, University of Nigeria, campus, 2000 to 2008. Justice Mwesi, who was a distinguished scholar, pro bono, Faculty of Law, University of Science and Technology, Institute. He was formerly a visiting Associate Professor of Law, Faculty of Law, Ebonyi State University, and member, International Advisory Board, Annual Survey of International and Comparative Law, Golden Gate University School of Law, Francisco, USC. Honorable Justice Nwezi is widely published, and his publications can be found in both national and foreign journals, including chapters in books, with well over 40 publications. He has attended a lot of conferences cutting across the continents. The honors and awards of Honorable Justice Nwezi include Nancy Pelosi Congressional Award 2015, Distinguished Scholarship Awardee, Golden Gate University, San Francisco, California, USA, Justice of the Year Award 1997, Rotary International District 1940 Award, Rotary Club UNEP Award for Professional Service 1998, Dignity of the Man Award UNM Alumni Association 2001. Award for Excellence, Law Students Association, Nnamdi Azikiwe University, Awka. Pan-African Distinguished Leadership Hall of Fame Certificate of African Students Union Parliament, 2016. Fellow Chartered Institute of Arbitrators of Nigeria, 2015. Honorable Justice Nwezi has delivered a number of far-reaching judgments. Some of the cases given by Honorable Justice Nwezi include, but not limited to, the following: Arun Saye and Ogedigbe and Adonda, 2009-30 Goodwill Reports of Nigeria, page 28, also reported in 2008, Law Pabino Electronic Law Reports, page 3701, Court of Appeal, Boron Shaw Kazim against the state, Palomo against Ogunse, Ashinola against Fatobi, Liti Bank PSC against K Plastics Nigeria Limited, Fato Info against Dada, ASWC against AIC Nigeria Limited. Some of the selected reported notable pronouncements of Honorable Justice Nwezi at Court of Appeal include, but not limited to, decision in Ojora against ASP Nigeria PLC, reported in 2014 one Nigeria Open Law Report, plus 1384, page 150 and page 193, paragraphs A to G, when my lord said, quote, "We find it curious that the learned senior counsel for the appellant could invite us to jettison the position of the Nigerian Supreme Court in favor of the position taken by the Court of Appeal in England on Jordan. As shown above, the appellant's counsel have contended that the English Court of Appeal in Goodfrey against Circuit held that A1 against Raphael Talk and Sons Limited was too narrow to represent the position of the law. Wonders shall never end. As indicated earlier, our latest court approvingly adopted the same demos against Raphael Talk and Sons Limited in Uku and others against Okumagba and others, and Peacock Investments Limited and Peacock Investments Limited. It therefore beats our imagination how many senior counsel expected this court to denigrate the authority of the final court in Nigeria in favor of the view of the subordinate foreign court. We do not intend to say more. This suffice to note that by the centurion and the capernaum in the Christian Bible, this court is under authority, under and subordinate indeed, submissive to the authority of the Supreme Court. Thus, irrespective of whatever any foreign court may postulate, we are bound by the authorities of who and others against Okumagba and others, and Pillock Investment Company Limited. It is only if and only if the APS court vacates his reasoning in the said cases that we can no longer follow them. That is the discipline warranted by the impregnable rule of stare decisis. And my lord referred to a number of cases day. On the jurisdiction of court, Honorable Justice Owesley, while at the Court of Appeal, also had this to say. Jurisdiction is to a court what a gate or door is to a house. That is why the question of a court's jurisdiction is called a threshold issue. It is at the threshold that is at the gate of the temple of justice. To be able to gain access to the temple, that is the court, a prospective litigant must satisfy the gatekeeper that he has a genuine cause to be allowed ingress. When he fails to convince the gatekeeper, he will be denied access to the inns of the temple. The gatekeeper, as vigilant as he is always, will readily intercept and query all persons who intrude in his domain. On issues pertaining to the Constitution, Honorable Justice Wesley again had this to say in the case of Ibrahim against Fulani, reported in 2009, Law Permission Electoral Law Reports, the 3279 Court of Appeal. It is the Constitution, the most fundamental law in Nigeria, which originated the idea of time frames in respect of the tenure of elected political offices to which election matters are tied. Thus, for the effectuation of this irreversible constitutional time frame, the factor of expeditious disposal of election petitions makes it imperative that time must be reckoned with. Indeed, anything short of that may even amount to sabotage against the reason they tap for inaugurating periodic elections into elective offices in a constitutional democracy such as ours. On academic certificates, Honorable Justice, the way they had this to say in Salami against Commissioner of Police, reported in 2009, all Federation Review Report, part 495. An academic quote, an academic certificate is an invaluable treasure. The route to its attainment must be characterized by transparency, perseverance, discipline, and hard work. These factors make its achievement a mark of distinction, a thing of pride. Nothing, therefore, must be done to taint its purity. is happy. Let us not do anything to scandalize our academic certificates in the eyes of the science international community. Unquote. Still on academics, in the case of Foreign Shock Kazim against the state, 2009-29, Weekly Reports on Nigeria, Honorable Justice Nwosi opined as follows, quote, a candidate becomes a student of a university when upon fulfillment of entry requirements, he is not only offered admission, but he actually takes a prescribed oath and enters his name in the register of the university. Upon entering his name in the register, also known as the matricula, from the Latin etymon matricula, he becomes a matriculant, that is, an enrolled or registered student of that university. That explains why the inaugural ceremony, which is where actualizes his membership of the university, community, is referred to as matriculation. By his registration, he acquires the status of a student. The Constitutive Act of each university delineates the tenure of such a registered student depending on his discipline or choice of study. Such a registered student remains a bona fide member of the university. I will only share that token upon graduation in the character and learning. Unquote. On the effect of suspension of a student from the university, Honorable Justice Nwosi opined in the same case as follows, quote, the word suspend traces its roots to the old French word suspendere, which yielded the Latin variant suspendere. It is the act of removing someone from a place temporarily as a punishment. In this particular context, suspension is the act of sending a student out of the university for a definite period as a punishment. It is thus the common purpose for this deviance. This punishment merely disrupts but does not truncate the tenure in the university. It merely puts it in abeyance. When he punishes himself for his misconduct, he resumes his tenure. On universities at Ivy Towers, Honorable Justin Wesley in Adeyanju against the University of Ilorin and others, 2011, All Federation Weekly Law Report, 569, further stated that, quote, universities popularly referred to as Ivy Towers are famous as residents of learning, as centers of robust, open, and engaging academic and scholastic disputations. Unbridled disputations that shape and world policies, that interrogate continuous and moribund assumptions, that generate hypotheses which almost always engender paradigm shifts in attitudes, tendencies, and societal goals. Perhaps the greatest contribution which Honorable Justice Nwosi has made to the development of the law in his stint in the Supreme Court is exemplified by the Sky Bank case. The Sky Bank case confronted the myth that the National Industrial Court is a final court. This was likely welcomed in the entire legal community because the provision of the Constitution apparently gave the National Industrial Court finality in matters pertaining to labor law and industrial relations. The lot fell on the Supreme Court with Honorable Justice Nwosi reading the lead judgment to deconstruct that myth. In that case, Honorable Justice Nwosi held that, contrary to the popular belief that the National Industrial Court was a final court on industrial relations, particularly employment-employee relations. Indeed, a litigant had a right to appeal to the court of appeal. This judgment was widely received. This judgment was widely received in the entire legal community. It not only gave employers a chance to appeal the decision of the National Industrial Court in appropriate cases, but it also offered hope to the employee who feels that his employment has been unjustly terminated by giving him another chance to ventilate his case at the Court of Appeal. We thank Honorable Justice Owusu for this landmark judgment. I cannot conclude this profile without giving you a sneak preview of what to expect in the lecture that is about to be delivered by Honorable Justice Owusu. Challenging the current academic curricula in our universities, where emphasis is placed on the study of foreign scholars and judges like Oliver Wendell Holmes, Cardozo, and other justices from foreign jurisdictions doing in the study of jurisprudence. Honorable Justice Mwezi, while extolling the virtues of the man we are honoring today, that is Justice Idigbe, advocated for what he calls the Idigbean doctrine. By the Idigbean doctrine, Honorable Justice Mwezi argued convincingly, in my view, that the time has come where emphasis is to be placed on the study of the works of our Nigerian judges and scholars in Nigeria. Mr. Vice Chancellor, our honorable judges, ESCJ, both at the Court of Appeal, the High Court, and our visiting judges, my deans represent, my fellow professors, students, ladies and gentlemen, kindly join me as I invite I want to kindly acknowledge the presence that is here today of our inaugural guest lecturer to deliver the 16th Justice Chukwuemeke Idigbe Memorial Lecture. My Lord, Honorable Justice Chima Sentus Owusu, PhD, JS. Thank you very much. You will deliver the lecture after the Vice Chancellor's speech.
Beloved faculty, today is your day. The Dean of the Faculty of Law, today is calling your day. My Lord, I don't want to go to Oko, so please permit me to stand on the protocol. It is with immense pleasure that I welcome you all to the 16th edition of the Justice Idigbe Memorial Lecture. This lecture was established by the late Chief Gani Fawemi with the goal of honoring one of the Nigeria's finest jurists, the late Justice Chukwuemeke Idigbe. I'm proud of the Faculty of Law and the past and present deans for sustaining this noble goal for decades. Please keep it up. In the tradition of ensuring that the lecture is qualitative, the Faculty of Law has invited a distinguished jurist and justice of the Supreme Court, Honorable Justice C.C. Mweze, PhD, to deliver this year's edition of the lecture. Given the very rich academic and professional background of our guest lecturer, I have no doubt that he will not just sustain the standard, but raise the standard of the lecture. On behalf of the Governing Council, management, staff and students of Idigbe, I wish to express our deep gratitude to Honorable Justice Mweze, PhD, for honoring my invitation despite his busy schedule. I hope that this visit will be the beginning of a warm and supportive relationship with the Peter Faculty of Law in particular and our university in general. While I enjoin everyone to be focused and fully take part in this lecture, I express my sincere appreciation to the team that ensured that Honorable Justice Mweze, PhD, is here with us to deliver this lecture. Thank you and God bless you all.
Thank you very much, our Vice Chancellor, Professor Momo, Dean, School of Medicine, is still looking around and wondering why are all the deans still seated when they know they have meeting by 2 o'clock. For the sake of this program, the Vice Chancellor has said we must all participate, and the meeting of the Provost Deans and Director for 2 o'clock has been rescheduled for 10 o'clock tomorrow morning. We want to recognize the presence of Honorable Justice VOA of Yahweh. I thought, Justice, we want to welcome you, sir. Honorable Justice S.O. Tomwe, that has the title, we want to welcome you, sir. We have here the Attorney General and Commissioner of Justice, Edo State, Professor Mrs. Linka Omorobe. They welcome. The Director General, National Institute for Legislative Studies, Professor Lai Lati, is here to be represented by Dr. Abiola and Dan Waka. I want to welcome you. Permit me to recognize the Dean Faculty of Law, Pace University, Professor C. Onuroko. If I am unable to pronounce your name properly, please bear with me. After this ceremony, I will come and learn. Professor Mrs. Onoa, we want to welcome you. Let me welcome you. Professor Mrs. Agbohel, we want to welcome you. Professor Mrs. Emabiwe, former Dean of Law, Igbenedion University. The Acting Dean Faculty of Arts, Professor Austin Moye, we want to welcome you. Among the first scholars, we want to welcome you. Thank you very much for coming around. We want to appeal to all of us. The names before us is endless, but just bear with us. After the lecture, we may have time to recognize some more persons. May I now welcome our guest lecturer to deliver this lecture. The University Bursar, Dr. Babila, presented by Pastor Ilarao. Thank you.
Mr. Vice Chancellor, kindly permit me to go straight to the business of the day. You agree with me that the conqueror has done very well in respect of protocol. The lecture is titled Constitutional Adjudication for Democratic Consolidation in Nigeria, the Role of the Supreme Court. Constitutional Adjudication for Democratic Consolidation in Nigeria, the Role of the Supreme Court. In this original form, it was a very lengthy lecture of only 1 page, computer type pages. I thank the dean and the presenters for skillfully reducing it to only 51 pages. Even then, I promise you, I will not bore you with the whole lecture, because I can see some of the students carrying bundles and bundles of copies of this lecture. So I will just take one or two aspects and throw the discussion open. The first, let me say this, the location of this lecture. It is not unusual for persons to sleep off. They are entitled to sleep off, provided they don't snore. So, in the lecture itself, we have the introduction, which will bemoan the marginalization of Nigerian scholars and tourists. Then we took a brief journey back into history in an attempt to reconstruct the person of Justice Chinwenke Idigbe of the Supreme Court. Then to be able to bring down our lecture to its fullest meaning, we decided to set out our understanding of the concept of judicial reasoning. From pages 19 to 25, the lecture takes on the idea of constitutional democracy, from the Greek roots through discussion in philosophy, political science, and all the rest of them. That is why I cannot bore you with these details. Essentially, we noted the universal characteristics of democracy and the mechanisms for holding leaders accountable, as ordained in the Constitution. Then, the concept of democratic governance under the Constitution, in particular, what society calls the judicialization of politics. Then, judicial guardianship of good governance in a democracy. Next, law students must be aware of this, but I want to assure you that the lecture goes beyond what your personal law lecturer deals with every day in his classroom. That is to say, the narrow view of the concept of rule of law. The lecture deals with the dynamic concept of the rule of law, because without rooting democracy to development, the majority of the people somewhere around Ubowo, is it Ubowo is called, don't look at you as big people talking to themselves. Then it is not that those who are in practice of democracy do not understand what the concept is all about. It is just because it's impossible for them to actualize it. And because of this, we set out the views of the real practitioners. And the contention that the whole idea of democracy is a mere myth. As a serving judge, I will not go to that extent. There are some redeeming features, but I'll leave you to come to the better judgments. Look at some Supreme Court judgments, and more importantly, another subject that's of abiding concern to this presenter. The question of socioeconomic rights. Then the subject of federalism and the technique of listing as a catalyst for constitutional agitation. This takes almost half of the paper because this is the area that generates a lot of tension. Dichotomy in legislative jurisdiction, the technique of division, the residual dichotomy in concurrent list, and the nature of distortion of power. If I may just say this in passing, you know, the military was in charge of affairs of governance for a long, long time. They hijacked the divisions in the regional constituents and dipped all of them in a unitary constitution called the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. And those who are complaining do not know the root cause of this problem. You'll find all this in the lecture. Then the other electoral decisions of the Supreme Court are tended to deepen our concept of democracy. And of course, in conclusion, we return to the subject of this presentation, that is to say, Justice Idigbe. Mr. Vice Chancellor, in the introduction, we make just two important points. In the first place, we note that an intimate reading of texts in jurisprudence and global legal literature emphasizes this dichotomy, personalization of Nigerian jurists and scholars. I had occasion during one of our vacations to go to one or two faculties abroad. There were so many Nigerian students offering law and hopefully hoping to come to Nigeria to practice law. The first thing I noted was that in their introduction to law, emphasis was still on English law and American law. But a couple of the students did not know anything about Nigerian legal system. But they want to come home to Nigeria to practice law after having taken an LLB or whatever in any part of the world. The problem is that perhaps Professor Dean of Law and all professors of law here, this all may well be ours. That we don't outsource the contributions of our jurists and our own scholars. Who can tell me that Professor Ben Wadese is not a known figure all over the world? It's not possible. But if you Google, if you have your laptop now, Google, like I've said, when you go in the VC's office, any of the leading journals, Harvard and the rest of them, chances are you may not encounter Professor Wadese in any of the discussions there. They mention very junior fellows in their own areas. And because of this, when I delivered Professor Omotala's lecture, I made the point, and I put myself here, that law teachers and students must be familiar with such names like Jeremy Bentham, John Austin, Lord Scope, Denning, and so on. These names constitute the distinctive contribution of English philosophy of law to the legal theory. And across the English Channel, the United States has donated such legendary personalities like Marshall C.J. Marshall C.J., by the way, was the one who introduced the question of judicial review in American constitutional law. It was not part of the thing historically. And because of his cultural relevance, he introduced it and it has become part and parcel of that institution, and indeed all other leading constitutions. Lord Wendell Holmes, Dean Roscoe Pound, Benjamin Cardozo, Leonard Hand, the experimentalist John Dewey, the jurisprudence and legal theory. Continental Europe is not left out. Hans Kelsen, Paul Savitzky, Karl Marx, George Hegel, Eugene Erlich would forever be memorialized for their imprint on legal reasoning. Although this is not the subject of this presentation, my initial impulse was to take on this as a subject, but I realized that we are going to have more than just lawyers, law professors, and law students. And that is why I decided to branch off into something that will appeal almost half of the participants here. In the introductory presentation, if I had embarked on that course of action, my assignment would have been to inquire into the question whether his lordship, Justice Idigbe, was able to establish an exportable model of reasoning, which is comparable to in any form of judiciality in any part of the world. And so, having avoided that question, what I will do here along this introductory part is a certain aperture through which you will view what his lordship was able to do while he was on the Supreme Court bench. Secondly, too many years ago, as a law student in the Faculty of Law, University of Nigeria, Enugu campus, our faculty invited Justice Idigbe as a guest lecturer. Not like the faculty invited me today. And I recall that he was not imbued with an intimidating frame. As law students, indeed, first year law students, who had been introduced to the judicial system, how the high Supreme Court is on the apex, the final court, and like Dean said a while ago, that the Supreme Court cannot bear, and so on and so forth.
I don't understand you.
As young boys and young girls, that all judges and justices who are there were equally huge and tall. In our youthful fantasies, when we beheld Justice Idigbe, he was not particularly tall. We were surprised that the Supreme Court up there would have all short people. But we were wrong. Seldom did we know that Benet, his short frame, was an embodiment of a chiaroscuro of noble traits. An abiding commitment to work. Work that had evolved from distinctive traditions and the tradition of industry. The tradition of excellence, the tradition of eloquent reasoning, and above all, the tradition of rectitude. These traditions define this mode of judicial reasoning that warranted an endowment of the annual. Permit this digression. From our actual research, we found that his lordship was in the Supreme Court from 1964 to 66 and 75 until he died. During this period, he handed over a total of 53 leading judgments and 248 contributions. In effect, he left behind a total of 301 judgments in the Supreme Court. It appears that the lordship wrote more than one dissenting opinion. For my intimate reading of these judgments, we are satisfied that the lordship led for us an indignant ethic of judicial industry. And we invite Atan Rafatai Williams, the Chief Justice of Nigeria at the time of the lordship led, listen to what former Chief Justice of Nigeria said about Justice Idigbe. I quote him, Justice Idigbe was a very embodiment of the law. He seemed to have it in his very bones. Yet, although he had all this legal knowledge, he also had a firm grip of principles and the rules of practice and procedure applicable in the law in the course of the Federation. He was forthright in judgments. He was clear and forceful, no judicial aim. This is like another time we are speaking, not me. In simple sentences and in words, which everyone in court understood, he would deliver his usually lengthy judgment with every point analyzed, explained, and resolved. He was so well versed in his knowledge of the law that he reached the right conclusion almost by instinct. When he came to provide his judgments, he would cite many judgments and cases all decidedly relevant.
They will rely on wrong quotations from other eminent judges of Bible days. He will then state the propositions of law and conclusions simply and clearly. That was why the judgments command such respect. His worship is system. What is more? He looked the part of a great and literary judge. His keen brown eyes, his distinctive features, his firm mouth, and strong chin showed the character of the man. He portrayed him as one who would uphold the law at all times. He would stand no nonsense on anyone. He was a fair and upright judge with a lifelong commitment to the cause of justice and the rule of law. A brilliant jurist by any standard. His learning was always one modestly. It was never used to deflect those who know or understand fairness. A very able judge, mentally vigorous, fair-minded, infinitely compassionate, and a lovable human being. That was Akai Williams speaking of Idigbe. Yes. Now, I imagine, and indeed I have always wondered, why the faculty of law of the University of Benin has not prompted one or two doctoral candidates to undertake an investigation into his works. Well, the dean is here, you will go home and think about it. But there is one area in which the worship failed. He told the legal community one debt. The indignant memoirs in his own words. Needless to say that many of us, judges, professors, vice chancellors, fail in this regard. Master Vice Chancellor, students in engineering and so on who want to find out what were those enabling environments? Were your parents very rich? Were they poor? What were those factors that propelled you into reading engineering up to this level where you became the vice chancellor, fellow scientist of engineering, particular science, and so on and so forth? You cannot do this. Only you can. His lordship did not do so. And it's regrettable. Now, I invite Professor Wabensey to tell us the essence of this kind of memoir. Listen to Professor Wabensey in his own book. He said, the story, my memoir is the story of a man schooled in the ways and practices of the very professional law. In the ideas and processes of constitutional democracy and the norms and ethos of modern life generally, but whose life, visions, and entire personality have from childhood been impregnated by the customs, traditions, and culture of the village. Professor is speaking. I have tried to tell the story of my life in full without keeping back anything that might be considered important. If I think, I will recommend to the lecturer in jurisprudence or alternatively legal methods. Make these three volumes, three books, compulsory reading for your students, and they will go away well formed. The story covers my friends, my childhood, my life as a primary and secondary school boy. My years as a university student, my intellectual development. The book is more than a story of the events that have occurred in my life. It's also a commentary on people and institutions and ideas that have played this significant part. I hope that the public will find it rewarding. Okay. I hope too that there are some lessons as well as some promise in the book for younger and future generations. This is the crux of the matter. There are some law students here who will definitely, by the special grace of God, become justices on the Supreme Court. Let somebody claim it. They will want to know. What look at justices of the Court of Appeal here? They were not born justices of the Court of Appeal. Something happened. Something propelled them. And by the special grace of God, they are where they are. Look at the chief judge of the United States.
the president of Osun Report of Delta State. Look at their losses. Look at Professor Father Ezike, the first Reverend Father to be made a professor of law in the whole of Africa. What were those factors that prepared them to achieve this big time? This is what students want to know, not just. Okay, let's talk about that. Now, judicial reasoning, what is my own understanding of judicial reasoning? It is the process of thought by which a judge reaches a conclusion as to the appropriate result in a case. And to the written explanation of that process in the public judgment. Each time a judge is reading a judgment, people are watching him. Lawyers are watching him. Senior advocates are watching him. They are assessing him. How porous or how blinded the thing is. The latter is the principal mechanism, that is law report, of the judgment of judicial accountability. And an explanation of the reasons for decision is owed not only to your successful litigants, but to everyone with an interest in the judicial process, including other institutions of government and not the public. Why must the Supreme Court or the Court of Appeal remove somebody who was reportedly elected as the governor of the state? People want to know. Gentlemen, are you with me? People want to know, what are those factors? Was he reading? Was he involved in all sorts of things? It's only the judgment that we explained. This is our understanding. And that is the process in which this lecture is involved. It goes on to investigate the judgments of the Supreme Court in its attempt to deepen democracy. So that the court does not just wake up and hand over a judgment, oh, Buhari was really elected without any explanation. We don't work like that. Though indeed, most of the elections in Nigeria have excited anxiety and provoked political tension in the polity. Post-election conflicts and as their personal schemes, the senior advocate is here, no matter that he's dressed like a chief, which he is. These election petitions have first their personal schemes and exacted judicial patience and formulated litmus tests. For the sustainability of our democratic governance. If the courts are not consistent, chances are that something will happen someday. We pray that doesn't happen. And that is why we must praise, whether we like it or not, we must praise the judiciary of this country for being able to sustain this experiment from 1999 to the present day. Now, from pages 19 to 20, we undertook 25 rather, a discourse on the idea of democratic governance, addressing issues through Pericles, Plato, and all the rest of them. And this connection to the Constitution presently, what are those universal characteristics enunciated in the Constitution? How has the Supreme Court dealt with those characteristics? Are they in consonance with judicial reasoning? These are the questions we have been able to tackle in this paper. Now, the next thing is the concept of judicialization of politics. How the judiciary has become more involved in day-to-day activities. Indeed, last week, the question of football, people who are playing football somewhere in jobs, came before the court. I said to my colleagues, we have a duty to resolve it. If not, some group of people will give themselves one day in the name or that the decision is not admissible in the court of law. It is. Every single thing comes before the court, and we are under obligation to resolve it one way or the other. Then, judicial guardianship of good governance of the democracy. Of course, the Constitution ordains the courts as a sentinel that guides and guides this democratic experiment. Interestingly, in the Second Republic, some judgments, those of you who are lawyers here would know, how the Supreme Court descended on some judges, particularly in the criminal matters. One of them was the Idigbe, the Director of Public Prosecution. He was there for so long, he was so knowledgeable in prosecution and so on. He was elevated to the high contempt. A younger lawyer came to prosecute a case. He forgot that he was already a judge and not a DPP. He was not impressed with the way the young man was conducting the case, so he attacked him. Regrettably and unfortunately, he was recording his questions. Whereas the young man asked only about 5 questions, he recorded 35 questions for himself. And that is the kind of problem. Now, people thought that, oh, this kind of mistake, how do we think? But the appellant went up to the Supreme Court. He needs to read the views of the court on this judge. I won't mention his name. We don't do such things. But more importantly, there is a more cogent responsibility of the judiciary. The dynamic concept of the role of the judiciary. That is why today, the courts cannot afford the answer of policy to matters that concern us. I give you an example. When Obasanjo was the president and commander-in-chief, he thought of a way of strengthening this democracy. The ICPC, the ICC Act and all that, the government of Ondo State went and argued. Look, how can we be there in Abuja and pretend to legislate for us how we're going to attend to corruption and all of that? The Supreme Court said no. We are past that stage. Although we are running a federation, we have a duty to protect this country. We cannot overlook this enormous problem. Listen to what the court pointed out. You know, it said, in foreign countries, Nigerians are regarded and treated as corrupt people. I mean, it'll be so. Unlike other nationals, no bank will allow Nigerians to open a bank account of surprise. The Nigerian credit passport is synonymous with corruption. Consequently, as foreign papers, Nigerians with green passports are separated from other nationals. Nigerians are subjected to degrading and inhuman treatment, are treated as pariahs on the ground by the Nigerians, who hail from one of the most corrupt countries in the world. What is next? So the Supreme Court intervened and upheld the ICPC Act and the FCC Act. Interestingly, consumer lawyers, you who don't agree with the Supreme Court, but I urge you to look at the raison d'etre of the reason. Yes. One thing as much as you have the right to pay their own view, like if some other reason were here, I would have said this to him. Go and look at the reasoning of the court, just like in Amechi and INEC in Port Harcourt. Amechi did not contest election, but something happened. The court said this man must be the governor because somebody was challenging the constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. That is beyond us in the presentation. Now, we have listed a whole host of these judgments. We shall not bore you. Let me just take one or two. If you, about 3 or 4 or 5 years ago, the city governor was possibly carried away from his office and dumped somewhere. Security men were there. You know what he did? He quietly went out to the court, from the Federal High Court to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court accepted him. Some national members of the House of Assembly have abandoned the sacred chambers and gone to some hotels after eating rich breakfast. They purported to remove their governor. The governor returned and went back to the court, up to the Supreme Court. Gentlemen, if the court did not take this kind of firm view, perhaps would have returned to the farm where we came from. I came from the farm, as some of you came from the UK. Now, interestingly, even those who make laws for us have taken divergent positions on the constitutional provisions of men for them. Some of these cases are going to court. Interestingly, the honoree of this lecture, the late Justice Idigbe, delivered a very powerful concurrent judgment in AG Bender, Gold Bender, and HR Interpretation. I invite you to go and read what you must have said there. Now, in the governor of Lagos State and Ojukwu, very old case, the position of the Supreme Court has remained like an anchor. The court said, the Nigerian constitution is founded on the rule of law, the primary meaning of which is that everything must be done according to the law. That's the narrow view, gentlemen. It means that government should be conducted within the framework of recognized rules and principles, which restrict discretionary power, which Coke colorfully spoke of as the golden and straight bedrock of the law, as opposed to uncertain and broken orders of discretion. This was the view of our brother who was buried here in the Middle Kingdom, I think about a month or so ago, Obaseki, the late Justice Obaseki. Now, the concept of the rule of law. In this lecture, for this proposition, we have supplied the decisions of the Supreme Court to show how the court has been able to advance the frontiers of democracy. Now, the concept of rule of law, there are two principal ways of understanding it. From the narrow perspective, looking at the state as a minimal state, whose duty is just the policeman states, thou shalt not commit any offense, thou shalt not steal, and all that. Once a state goes down to that level, woe betide the citizens of that country. Our understanding, and that is the position we canvass in this lecture, is the dynamic concept of the rule of law, which traces its roots to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the Revised Convention on Human Rights, and the host of conferences. These conferences charts a link between democracy, development, and all of that. There's no way you can parade yourself as being a democrat, whereas half of those left behind have not had their breakfast. It's not possible. Now, the sustainability of democratic government through the rule of law, namely dynamic concept. Here we have set out the views of prominent actors, first the former CEOs of Nigeria, who held the view that good governance and respect for the rule of law promote peace and prevent conflict. Gentlemen, if the Niger Delta Avengers succeed in destroying all of shares and the rest of oil installations, will anybody see a concept of democracy? No way. So our own idea of democracy is that form of government that ties a link between peace, good governance, responsible governance, and also representation. Indeed, this view finds them root in the views of the common people. Very lengthy quotation, and I read the dangers of writing. Let's use the case of this. Who is now the governor of
Kano? Listen to
this. There is a connection between the disrespect of the rule of law in democracy and general insecurity in our society. Democracy is ideally meant to provide maximum security for the greater number of people as well as improvement in their welfare. Security here does not just mean what the governor of the state was, so much infrastructure. When injustice and brutality in the pressure of civil society is carried out in the name of maintaining law and order, as exemplified by judicial killings, crackdown of journalists, illegal arrests, kidnapping, or assassination of opposition politicians, and the harassment and detention. Banning of popular organizations, repression carried out by the police and other security apparatuses, the gap between the state and the civil society is nauseatingly aggravated. This case of affairs has negatively impacted on the principle of good governance in Nigeria since the resolution of democracy. There's no case. This is the case. The principle of the rule of law is like all other attributes of liberal democracy, such as accountability, transparency and human rights promotion and protection, an essential element of democracy, without which the process, dynamics, success of the dynamics, democratic society is likely to be endangered. Some will say, bereft of its inherent value and sanctity. Put differently, Without the rule of law, democracy is impossible, as arbitrary finance is likely to go through and compare the process of realizing good governance. Now, to compound this political problem, that is what Professor Joseph has called preventer politics. Preventer politics simply means that if the Basuyi of Benin Kingdom decides to cast aside this is the regalia and becomes the governor of Edo State, he will go back to his school days and bring his own weight as Attorney General, his senior president as chief accountant, and all of that, whether they are qualified or not. Thus, a public affairs analyst has said that true democracy must frontally recognize the people as the owners of political parties, and by extension, owners of democracy. And not a fiefdom of a few privileged individuals. If a few individuals own our political parties, we are living in our sense to say that the people of Nigeria own their democracy. Once a few people control the democracy, gentlemen, I will leave the rest of the conclusion to you.
No, I have to.
Whether democracy belongs to us or to them. The few will also inadvertently control economic means and ultimately operate the economic system in such a manner to permit the concentration of wealth on the means of production and exchange in a few hands. Whether this is true or not is not left for me. You are well qualified to come to the judgment on this. And that is why some people have argued that the whole idea of rule of law and democracy are all practical concepts. And the notion that everybody is equal before the law is a myth which has no basis. Gentlemen, as a sitting judge, as a serving judge, I will not promote this kind of view. There are negative features, there are negative aspects, but this is far too damning conclusion. Then, although this is not a garden of lawyers only, I think the meeting, let me just point out one or two judges. For those of you who are engineers, who are not very let me say, under the 1963 Constitution, there was what was called the doctrine of political question. The courts acted like court spirits. Once such a matter came up, there was an answer to it. Even during the Second Republic, certain questions were also classified as political questions. And that was how Honorable Musa was removed without anything. And indeed, about 2-3 weeks ago, the Speaker of the then House of Assembly was arraigning himself as a proud man who had no regret for removing the former governor. Now, but interestingly, the courts have now evolved a new attitude, which has changed their perception. If you recall, I mentioned his name before. Former governor of Rivers State, which is this attitude, and give the man the first time. Again, scholars have written extensively, their criticized his report, and I urge you to go back to the views of their lordships who sat on that panel and the reasons for that conclusion. Even if you are not a lawyer, please ask your Basuyi of the Edo Kingdom to give you copies of the judgment. It's written in plain English. You will see why their bosses came to that judgment. Now, interestingly, impeachment was also characterized as a political question. Indeed, a senator from Abia State, who was a deputy governor in Abia, was removed. Nothing happened. But today, all that has changed. Nearby, my lord, from oh my lord, the state very close to you, you don't have what they did to their governor. But they threw away the governor in Roman's hotel or something. What was it that did? The governorship had no choice. I mean, the governor had no choice. He could not muster an army of folks. He simply went back to the court. And that was how the matter was solved. And so the Supreme Court has risen to this occasion and The concept of political question is now a guidance concept. It's not that kind of white thing. Now, the Electoral Act, we'll always remember as one legislation that has circumvented the resolution of right-taking constitutional questions. If you remember, just some months after the 1999 election and all of that, somewhere in other states, some people wanted to remove the local government chairman. This is what said we cannot do that, because the constitution is the supreme law of the land. Whatever you practice under the benefit has come and gone. We are now operating a new system of government in which the constitution, only the constitution, can speak. Now, let us come to the concrete question that concerns everybody, social economic rights. All the lawyers here, if I say that lawyers, practicing lawyers are failed, that would be a very high judgment. Every day lawyers carry their books to the courts. Freedom of movement, freedom of speech, freedom of worship. Look, the old interpretation of section 666 is no longer valid. Okojie and Attorney General of Lagos is no longer valid. I invite you to Anache and Federal Republic of Nigeria. What did Kitobi said in that? The wordings of the constitution. If the constitution provides otherwise, when you get copies of this lecture, you will get the document from it. Interestingly, the African Charter, Nigeria has always expected it. Knowing that Nigeria, and indeed Africa, cannot afford one-sided legislation, that is, freedom of rights, social economic rights, amalgamated the whole aggregate of rights. First, second and third generation. That is even long after, in Tehran, the indivisibility of human rights are not located. I invite you to the judgment of SERAC and Nigeria, what the African Commission said. It says, listen, international law and human rights must be responsive to African circumstances. What are the African circumstances? Ignorance. This one. And all of that. If Africa, international law is not responsive to African Commission, then it's not for us. And so, economic and social rights are essential elements of human rights in Africa. How can social economic rights be important to us when, from Okojie and Bayesian of Lagos, that old court says that Section 660 meant social economic rights clearly entrenched as fundamental objectives in chapter 2 as not necessary. Gentlemen, I say this with all seriousness. When we read an actual and FRN, we see how we can navigate out of this problem. Indeed, we have cited examples from South Africa, Uganda, Ghana, and Malawi. What other smaller African countries are doing for the interest of the majority of the citizens? We have cited two constitutions which have revolutionized and the whole process, and indeed rendered the tension between monism and dualism as mere hyper-patter. Like in Nigeria, after independence, we inherited the British system, where the Queen signs treaties, then the National Assembly domesticates them, that is, they nudge them to law. But in America, we are forgotten that we inherited the 1999 Constitution and 79 Constitution, inherited the American system of government. In that system, Article 12 of the United States Constitution clearly provides international treaties form part of the laws of the land. I mean, the whole host of issues. Then we have cited the Burundian Constitution of 2005, which appeared to be one of the most generous African constitutions. Article 19 of that constitution makes the International Covenant on the Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, CEDAW, and all of that integral parts of the constitution. We have cited examples from Namibia and Malawi. constitution that upheld the evidence of international law for the constitution. That's interesting. It is in the interpretation clause of the South African constitution that great credit goes. And indeed, we have cited in 2.7 the groupings of articles which this provision has covered and generated. Indeed, the right to third generation right to a satisfactory and healthy and clean environment has been enshrined in over 60 constitutions in the world. National courts and regional and coastal regional courts have begun to give life and concept interdependence and indivisibility of human rights. And so, Mr. Vice Chancellor, we don't believe it. Now that the National Assembly is trying to amend the position, it is my humble plea that they should do something about the socio-economic crisis inaugurated in Chapter 2 as one of the objectives. It doesn't mean that all of them are going to be just the same. There are most of them, like education, health, and so on and so forth, that can be inaugurated like Abacha did in 1995 in his constitution. Abacha, in all his whatever, knew that the right to health, education should be elevated to fundamental rights. Unfortunately, that was shown in the light of the day. Then the next segment deals with judicial responses to the notion of border stability and how that restrictive view has impaired our democratic experiment. And we are hoping that NGOs, human rights NGOs, somebody, can you imagine, when the soldiers were there, lawyers were rushing to come to the village. Ever since politicians came on board, I don't know what happened. They have all disappeared. Okay. Please, devise new means of coming back to the courts and try and try. If you fail and not succeed, you keep trying. One day, the panel of the Supreme Court will listen to you. Then from 1963 to 77, we take on the problematic of federalism and the technique of listing as catalysts for constitutional application. Almost all the cases from 1999 to the present day revolve around this. Within the federal government, whether it is Attorney General of Lagos and AG Federation, and all the rest of them, who has responsibility? Is it exclusive? Is it concurrent? And all the rest of them. But dealt with this, 73 to 77. Then, if you look at listen to what the Supreme Court, the Guardian, the Black Sheep said after the decision of Ayer and Musa. Plural democracy is enshrined by the opportunity for as many parties as satisfied the legal and constitutional requirements to contest elections. What is required to have more players on the political scene to expand the scope of political expression? That was how Nigeria began to operate too many political parties, indeed, more than all the other countries in Africa combined. But also cited the case of AG Abia and AG Federation, where the governments of the 36 states to the Attorney General, by declaration, the National Assembly can neither decrease nor increase the tenure of councillors and their chairmen. This was a very interesting judgment which gave support to political chairmen and so on. Interestingly, every chairman has a special assistant, a personal assistant, an assistant to the personal assistant. And you can imagine that in one local government, this judgment serves well over 200 or 300 people. Just coming, it's in 18 days in the trouble of democracy. Now, having said all this, we now come back to election decisions out there sustain democracy. We have cited cases like PDP and Silva on the internal democracy. I'm sure that somebody from my neck will be here. Why is it impossible for us, for the political parties, accommodates this principle of internal democracy. BPDP and Silva, the Sinkafi and Yari, and Uhu and Arumen, listen to what the former citizens said. If we want to instill sanity into our human affairs, if we want to entrench a political democracy in our polity, naked truth must emerge through the blood, nerve, and brain of each and every one of us. Although credit may not always have its rightful place in politics, we should try to break the two, attain a fair, just, and egalitarian society where no one is oppressed. Let us call a spade a spade. Gentlemen, shall we call a spade a spade? It's all there for you. The Vice Chancellor, I'm sorry I have taken so much of your time. There are so many of these decisions. If we take all of them, we cannot return to official functions. And so, on page 110 of my original paper, I come to what I call the review of conclusion. In this very short presentation, we have merely dealt with some of the benefits which personal education has brought to bear on democratic constitution in Nigeria. Subject is truly vast, that it's impossible to exhaust in a very short period, such as one hour presented to me. We shall therefore yield the floor to others to take on the assignment from there. For now, I invite you to return to the late GK Idigbe test, who, as shown above, was quote, a brilliant jurist by any standard. The learning was always won modestly. Question: how many professors were there learning modestly? It was never used to deflect those who know or understand others. A very able judge, mentally vigorous, fair-minded, infinitely compassionate, and a lovable human being. Mr. Vice Chancellor, I thank the Dean for the Faculty of Law and the Organizing Committee. Interestingly, I'd like to look at the last page. Acknowledgement. Page 51, have you seen it? The faculty acknowledges the general support of the National Law School set for 1984. That's my class. We're also making this event a real success. So I want to thank my class for making this possible. I thank the Dean and the Organizing Committee for inviting me. I must deeply regret for inflicting this views on you, this has happened. Thank you very much, Nida.
Please, another applause. Thank you very much. No, please. Professor Richards, Idigbe, PhD. Come and take the vote of thanks. We pass forward. One of the people recognized by his time is Felicia Olafe, representative chairperson. Vice Chancellor Mrs. Mary Ejeko, FIDA, Federation of International Women Lawyers, and the state branch, we want to recognize. Professor Mrs. Adeku, we also want to recognize. The Dean Faculty of Law in Nigerian University, Professor Ejaola Opankore, we want to welcome you. Thank you for coming around.
Sublime ladies and eminent gentlemen, I've been saddled with a function which I believe is minute in any way you look at it. Minute the way we are going to do it, minute because we have to make it minute to give time for everybody to go. Certainly, you have seen for yourself, you have heard for yourself, that before us, the guest speaker is a doyen of law, an embodiment of law, who is a member of the literary system. He has his foundation in gold when we talk about legal development and growth in Nigeria. Our big personality is, no doubt, he has endowed us with a diet of legal philosophy. And I have to thank him. He has done a lot, no doubt, and I don't know how to start. For instance, to all you students there, you are in faculty of law. From next year, you will be benefited by what the guest lecturer, has given to us. He has graciously donated his honorary, whatever he is entitled to, in form of money, to all those in jurisprudence. Anybody, the best student in jurisprudence, and the best student in human rights law. I believe I'm correct. I know that of jurisprudence. I also know that human rights law. International law, yeah, which is part of human rights law, part of international law, when overstretched. But I dare say that international law and jurisprudence as such, you will be entitled to this if you are the best student in any of this area. So I think that deserves a round of applause. He's generous. He has a generous mind. He can dance with generosity. He can dance with generosity from the point of view of the doyen of law that he is. But you see, custom demands, as you expressed, my profound gratitude to him for all that he means to this system, to Nigeria, as the interpreter of law per person. And so I will do it because custom so demands on an occasion like this. But I'm afraid, Mr. Chairman, that our guest lecturer, His Lordship Justice Wesley, C.C. Wesley, with whom I have been in contact over the years, deserves much more than what custom dictates. It is therefore in all sincerity that I bend back and make bold to say, sir, that you are eminently entitled to this profound thanks and immense gratitude, which I here express on behalf of this university, on behalf of faculty of law, on behalf of humanity, and on behalf of God. But I will still conclude without us saying this, that when in 2015 I phoned to tell him, indeed, I don't want him to phone whether he's still using that number. He quickly received it and said, yes, Professor Yugo. I was shocked, dumbfounded, but I mustered energy to go ahead to tell him what I want him. That I want him to be the next Idigbe lecturer, memorial lecturer. And he readily accepted. But he said the time I'm going to give him will be too short because he has to cope with electoral tribunal. I mean, that was after the election. He told me, he said, I should give him something like 6 months because to enable him to tidy up everything, time was not friendly to wait for that one. And so I engaged one of our own thereafter, the president of NBA, that appeared here last year. Luckily for me, my friend, the Dean of Law, incumbent that took over from me, identified with the reasonableness of having this doyen of law and a jurist to do justice to one to whom honor is due. And that is Justice Idigbe of blessed memory. Please a round of applause for that. We have come so far. If anything I say here and we are thanking him immensely is eminently merited. But please, sir, I'm not spending any further discussion in that. Let me extend this message. I mean, this thank you message to all others who are attending. I will say it in general. All members of this high table, anyone qualified to be this high table, but presently sit there. I want to thank you for ever coming to do justice to one to whom honor is due. That's the general things. In particular, I want to thank the chairman of this occasion. He gave us everything we needed to perfect his occasion. Please thank the Vice Chancellor, Peter Solomon. I also want to thank members of his team, management team. Yes, and today is a very important day for our students and for the university. For them to be here, not thinking of going immediately. I said that is an object of joy for me as it is to all of you down there. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, and good luck to this very beautiful management team. I want to thank the CJ of Edo State. And if I have any member of Edo State, please, can we just accept that I'm also thanking you? But essentially, I want to thank the CJ of Edo State and the team, all the judges, members of the bench that accompany the CJ of Edo State to this place. To do justice and honor to one to whom honor is due. I sincerely thank you immensely. I want to thank all those who ever delivered in the memorial lecture in retrospect. Perhaps seeing one, a formidable member and who came from my faculty, time honored personality, and who is in the regalia of the chieftaincy title that he actually earned some years ago. Unless we hear those of us, sir, I thank you.